I'm gonna get comfortable.
Yeah.
I'm gonna be all over the place.
All right, Kate Hudson, it is fantastic to see you, be with you, spend some time with you,
so
photograph
nice.
You, now talk to you.
Yay.
So thanks for coming on the podcast.
Of course.
We're going to talk about Glass Onion. It's so much fun. It's so good, dare I say, as good if not better than the first one. and you play Birdie Jay, which is a character that everyone loves. Like you Aww. Just... fall in love with this character for all of her flaws.
Many flaws. It felt that way on the page too. You know, you kind of fell in love with Birdie reading the script because on the page she was just as vibrant and as hilarious as she ended up, which was really fun for me to see come to fruition.
Well, what's great about her too is obviously she's got some zingers that are amazing. Like the lines are great.
So
but
funny.
It's physical. There's a lot of physical comedy here too that you get to do.
It's the first thing I talked to Rian about was that I saw her physicality immediately. I was like, oh my God, her body language. It felt like a dance to me. Like I felt like I could just move into that body. And I thought, you know, that's something that, you know, you are want to feel as organic as possible, and I knew I could bring that to Birdie. And I said that to Rian, like, I can feel the walk. That was really fun for me to play with.
What was it like working with Rian Johnson?
Oh, he's the best. We're on these group texts, you know, our whole Glass Onion family, and he's such a good writer. Even when he's texting, he's a good writer. I feel lucky that I even get texts from this writer. Let alone know him and love him and now be friends with him. He's such a wonderful man. I kind of put Rian in a category of one of the great directors working right now. And working with him never felt like that. I never felt intimidated by him in any way. I felt like he was so warm and gracious. It was like he wanted us to, you know, be center stage. There was nothing about Rian that ate up any air in the room. He only, like, brought more oxygen, and I just loved him.
So coming together with Birdie Jay, creating it, right? Like, mm-hmm. So creating the walk and creating the kind of the way she talks and the cadence.
Yeah.
And working with that, with the costume director, because the clothes are amazing.
Jenny brought this whole other layer to Glass Onion, and walking into her fitting room was like, you know, it's like why you get into wanting to become an actor. You know, I walked into that fitting room and I just saw Birdie everywhere. The silhouettes and the fabrics and the glitter and the prints. I feel like it's not very often that you get to sort of create these avatars of a character, you know? And that's what Jenny is trying to kind of create to help us get into these characters. That was a huge part too. It was like, you know, slipping Birdie on and just like, it was like getting right into her. I mean, that first costume I wear, well, not the first one, the sort of the one on the dock with the mm-hmm. pantsuit with the
big
hat.
Walk.
Yeah, getting into that costume was like, I don't know how you can't get right into character. I feel like I can speak for everybody on that everyone had that feeling and experience with Jenny. And then there's the other part of Birdie, which is there's a whole bunch of layers that I played with that was really fun. And I think she's quite tragic, actually. And I think all of these characters are tragic. When you're playing some characters that are so comedic, it's so important to have that underbelly. I mean, it's where you find a glimmer of hope in a character that is so terrible. If you can see the cracks a little bit, I think, then you can kind of love to hate them and then inevitably maybe just kind of love them. And so really working on that was fun too. And Rian gave me so much opportunity to build all of those layers on this character.
I know she says some hateful things, but yet we love her when she's saying them. For me to see you in this part, I was like, yes, it's so great because it's one, your timing is just perfect, and you're so invested in Birdie Jay that the audience is as well. Like, there's just not one false note. We're with you the whole way.
Thanks. And thanks. That means a lot.
It's great to see in this ensemble, in this bigger, ginormous behemoth of a franchise.
Yeah.
It's so great to see it all working.
I felt really honored to be a part of it. You know, it's the business can be challenging, and there's a lot of times where you're like, put me in the game, coach. I'm like sitting on the sideline, you know. And I think Rian really gave me that opportunity right now to be in something, you know. These movies aren't made very often anymore. This is a franchise, but it's also a different kind of franchise, which is really refreshing. They're few and far between to become a part of, to be a part of. And so the fact that Rian wanted me to do that, I was so excited, you know, because it's been a while since I've been in a production like that. I mean, I've been like momming and business oriented, and then to be back in this sort of creative space, all these amazing actors, I was like, oh, this is why I love it. So mm-hmm. I'll always love it. I think some people, after working in our industry for a long time, can feel exhausted by the process and kind of, I don't know, beaten down a little bit mm-hmm. by the amount of criticism, especially for women. I think there's so much scrutiny. You know, with the great comes the bad. Like, it's always a catch-22. I don't know how I've figured out how to, like, cut all that noise out, but I think I'll always want to just be a part of this little weird, wild, creative world mm-hmm. called movie making. And so this movie was really a reminder of what the best of that is for me. It was like, oh, I'm working with these incredible actors, which always puts you on your best game, and with amazing writing, with a director you feel absolutely, completely held by. And this was the dream, you know, when you're a little girl. And for me, like, witnessing great directors working with my parents, you know, I'm like, it's still magic. And every once in a while, like, Kurt, my dad, will say, every 10 years, you get the good one, you know? Mm-hmm. You get that feeling again that's like, oh, yes, like, that felt exactly like what the dream was always. That's really what this experience was for me, for sure.
Yeah, I think of Kurt. I mean, I remember he was like computer who wore tennis shoes.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, he'd been at it a long time. Like, he was
nine. Kurt was 9 years old.
That is just crazy.
His first job was in an Elvis movie, and he kicked Elvis's shins on the boardwalk. That was his very first job, which is kind of
so
like
crazy. What was your very first job?
Party of Five. That was my first
and
job.
How old were you?
I was 16.
Wow.
And my mom actually let me do it because it was only, like, you know, a couple of days off of school. But I started auditioning at 16. And then my first job was this little weird movie called Ricochet River in Bend, Oregon. The memories I have on that movie are more vivid than, like, memories I had on other films that I've done.
Of course. It's your first
right? Yeah, yeah. I mean, it was really fun. And that was a really good first experience.
Were your parents discouraging at all, or were they encouraging?
No, my parents aren't like that. They're super encouraging. Their only concern was the why. What is it that you find so appealing about this life? Because for them, it's like, as I know now, when your kids, it's like Ryder, he's definitely going down the same road. If you have a performer child, you know it from the beginning. I think that was what they knew about me. They just wanted to make sure that I wanted to do it because I really loved the craft, not because it was like about the notoriety or the validation or the fame. Kurt, you know, asked me, he was like, if I told you you'd spend the rest of your life doing community theater and you'd be supplementing your finances doing another job, like, what would you say? I'm like, I would be doing community theater. He's like, then you're in the right business.
Yeah.
And I think that's the right way to look at it, because it's so tumultuous. You know, one minute you're up here and the next minute you're there. The one was you're up here and then you're up there. I think every actor has had those experiences, even in great success. So because of that, I think they were totally encouraging.
Also, I will say that I remember vividly when everyone knew Kate Hudson was obviously almost famous, right? That was giant.
That was Penny Lane, a whirlwind.
We still use that character name for someone that can always, like, get in
so
anywhere.
Amazing.
It's like
Ryder's generation. That movie holds up so much that even his friends are actually, like, quoting it or knowing who I am through that film, which is, to me, it's just such a testament to that movie. I mean, the fact that it holds up like that, and then every generation is discovering it. So cool.
Yeah, and you were nominated for an Oscar.
I was. And I remember, like, when the Golden Apple, my Uncle Marty Martin Short gave me this award very early on. And I was 21, you know, I'm looking up and I'm like, Uncle Marty's, like, honoring me. I was like, what is happening? It was just such a whirlwind. And simultaneously, I had fallen madly in love, which really grounded me during that time. Because I really just wanted to like be cozied up with my husband, soon to be ex-husband. You know, but then back then it was like it was a great balance to what was happening, because it was such a, I mean, I was so young and it was such a whirlwind.
Did anybody say to you, Kate, what are you doing? Don't get married. Don't fall in love now. You're just your career. Now you have to focus only on work.
I think people asked my mom more than they said anything to me. My family is like, hey, you're going to do what you're going to do. I mean, we grew up in a patchwork family, and yet we're so close. So we're doing something right. They saw how much I loved him. They knew that was what I was going to do, whether they gave me their permission or not. What are you going to do?
No, it's amazing.
Right? You either embrace it or you create a problem. Yeah.
It is incredible from the outside to watch, because you were just this, like, the next thing or the thing. Everyone was obsessed. And then in the midst of that, you get married. You, like you said, you started momming.
Yeah.
Right? And then...
And then I did How to Lose a Guy in 10 Days.
How to Lose a Day, which was huge.
But then that, what that did, which was really interesting, is then everything that was really coming my way were rom-coms. And that's kind of how people really wanted to see me. And as an actor, that's a very hard thing to do, because you're like, oh, I want to make people feel good and I love that. But there's this whole other side of me. Mm-hmm. I like the character actor. And so trying to find that balance throughout my career has been really challenging.
This is kind of an interesting question, but I know you learned a lot from having, you know, Goldie Hawn as a mom and Kurt Russell as a dad in this business, how they both embrace life, their own relationship, all of that stuff. And having had the pleasure of being in their company a few times, they're absolutely delightful parents, I should say.
They're full of life. They're awesome.
Yeah. And full of life and all of that.
I get now that I'm older, like I can see it from the outside. But the reality is from the inside out, I would think it's like any other family, except that my parents are in the movie industry. Mm-hmm. But they moved us to Colorado and wanted us to have like a really normal upbringing, almost to the point where they overcompensated for that maybe a little bit too much. Yeah. Like, they're also so honest, as Oliver would say, almost too honest. Like, we didn't need to know everything about your guys' relationship. Like, we would have family meetings, like, if shit would hit the fan in the family, like, it was like, family, sit down. Kurt's thing was, this is us, and we do this together. When he gave her a ring, he said to us, Kit, me, and Ollie, here's the thing. No matter what happens with your mom and I, no matter what, I'm going to be here for you guys. And that was like a real aha moment for Oliver and I, that you can have a relationship with your lover, your partner, and then you can also have an amazing relationship with your children. And those things don't have to be mutually exclusive. They can exist harmoniously no matter what. We just got lucky because they're still making it work. They're actually cuter now than ever. They're, I don't know what's right going on. It's so cute.
We all idolize them, and you know, you think about Kurt and Goldie, and it is like one word now.
Right.
Basically.
Yeah.
It's great. Well, what was it like to go on that first day walking on the Glass Onion set? What was that feeling like?
That was the best.
Because you guys
really
were in Greece.
Fun. The first day, I walked from my house down to a beach, onto a dock, into a water taxi. And that was my transportation to set. I was like, this is the best movie ever. I mean, it was 5 a.m. The ocean was like glass. It was so beautiful. It was hot. And I was like, this is going to be really fun. And the Greece part was insane. I mean, we were so set up, you know. It was like, we were very, you know, contained, which was really nice.
COVID rule, yeah, all
yeah, because of COVID. And then we had to go to Serbia, which is it was like two different movies.
Mm-hmm. Well, it also reunited you with Catherine Hahn, right? We were talking about How to Lose a Guy, and I'm so happy for her. It's so great to see her. Like, she's been around for a while, working and really getting a moment.
So great. She's the best.
Yeah, she really is.
That was really special for me because Catherine and I were really close on How to Lose a Guy. And we fell in love with each other then. We're still in love with each other. I mean, I auditioned Catherine. It was her first movie. And I remember she came in and we were doing auditions for my girlfriends. And Catherine came in, sat down, started her audition, and her phone rang in her purse. And she was like, oh my God. And she was like, she's like, hi, Patrick, I can't. And she took the phone call. And I was like, oh my God, I love this. Yeah. I love her so much. And I remember Linda Obst, the producer on it, was like, I'm like, done. Yes. Like, she didn't even need to finish the audition. She was just so, her energy was so great. You know, we were like, we're friends for years. And then as life happens, as you have your kids, as you're working on different projects, we never saw each other. And so this was really like a real reunion for us. And when we saw each other, it was like we both could have burst. We didn't. No, I actually think I did get emotional. It like brought me, got me all welled up because we were such babies.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm ready. I'm just going to say I'm ready for a reunion, a Kate and Catherine. I think that is a movie or something that needs to be seen because your chemistry is fantastic. And I think people would give the people what they want.
Just put a camera on us. We'll just go.
Right.
You know, give us like some props.
Speaking of that way.
Give us some props and then we'll just figure it out.
I have to ask you because Daniel told me about Mafia, as he says it with his accent.
You guys
played this game and that
we did.
That Janelle came like would bring like props and costumes, but
yeah, Janelle somehow found or carries with her a top hat and a cape. When she walked into this mafia night with that cape on, I literally was like, now she either went out in Serbia and found this, which I don't know, there's no way, or she packs with a cape and a top hat, which to me makes me love her. Mm-hmm. I talk about that. Iconic. She's ready for any occasion.
And she's so good in the movie. So would you say that she was the best at mafia?
I think we had a couple pretty good players. I mean, Janelle is great. Although Janelle did keep thinking everyone was mafia. I think she just liked the drama of being like, and you are mafia.
Yeah.
Usually it wasn't. Edward was very good. Leslie Odom Jr., don't sleep on Leslie. He's a bit of a shark when it comes to mafia. He's also a great host. So he hosts the game really well. Mm. And Jess is good. We had a couple like people that people don't know that, you know, on the crew that were really good. Daniel is probably the least.
Yeah, that's what he said.
Yeah, no, I mean, he was like, no.
Yeah.
You know, like, I'm like, but Daniel, that's not how the game works. Like, you gotta just play, you gotta, just, I mean, anybody, does anybody look suspicious? He's like, no. You know, like, okay, just you drink.
Yeah.
You have your drink, Daniel.
Well, that's what he said. Like, in fairness, it's pretty complicated. And then the more you drink, the more complicated it gets, I guess.
Yeah, but Daniel was great when it turned into a dance party, I have to say. We got down. I mean, Janelle with DJ and like, what else are we going to do but play mafia and then have a dance party?
Well, I will say that it really does, the chemistry. You never know how people are going to be on a shoot or whatnot. But that chemistry really, what was happening off screen is happening on screen.
Yeah.
You feel it. It was like a great group.
I think Rian understood. I think he knew. I think when he met everybody and he could feel it, it was like putting a dinner party together where we're going to make sure everybody, we're such in tight quarters. We couldn't really play with anybody but each other. That doesn't sound right. So he knew that we needed to be the kind of people that could connect and have a good time and leave any ego elsewhere. And that's what happened.
Glass Onion is a great kind of reintroduction to you.
I want to be very specific about the people that I'm working with now. If I get an opportunity to work with great directors, like that's really what I want to be focused on. And I feel really lucky that I actually can do that. You know, I can take a step back and I can kind of really make the movies that excite me. I just want to like wait for things that really inspire me. I think Glass Onion did that, really reinvigorated that for me, which was working with people that I admire was just, that's where I want to be. It's where I feel safest. When you're in a relationship that makes you feel safe, you feel like you can jump off that cliff, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And the same thing goes with director, actor. You can jump off the cliff and know that there's going to be a big old safety net down there. And you don't have to be afraid to take chances. Same thing with Birdie. Birdie's loud and big and bold. It's like, if I couldn't go super far without having that beautiful, genius, talented director sort of helping me craft what that was, you know, it could have been a very different performance.
Mm-hmm. I'm asking everybody this season a question about the little wins.
Ooh.
So, and I know you have three kids and a career. There's lots of chaos happening in your life. What's been a tiny win lately for you?
You know, the little win for me recently really kind of has been being a part of this movie, Glass Onion. You know, it very rarely do you read a character that you love so much that you're, you know, you just put yourself out there to, you know, want to get the part, but then to get the part, but then to have the great experience, truly great experience, then to have the outcome when you sit in that movie theater, feel that enjoyment, like that collective enjoyment of a theater like so ready for a movie like this, to see all of that come together. It's so rare that moments like that happen. It gives me the chills, like I just got the goosebumps. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't happen very often in a career, you know? It can only happen really a couple times like that, unless you're like Meryl Streep. I mean, little win, I would say a little bigger than a little win.
Yeah, I was just gonna say, a little win for me is a great cup
for
of coffee.
It's like a big win, but since we're on the topic.
Of winning.
Yeah. of like what that feels like, because it doesn't happen. But I think a little win for me would be, oh, you know what a little win is? Is just a really well-made matcha latte.
That's your drink of matcha latte. Just, we were making someone, one for you earlier today.
And someone
today.
Just handing it to me like today. That was a little win today. I walked in and Brad, my publicist, just handed me an oat matcha latte. And I was like, oh, I love you so much.
That counts. That definitely is a little win. And it's such a great LA moment too. I love you, Kate Hudson. Thank you
I love
so
you.
Much for coming
Thanks,
on. It's so
fun.
Great to see you and catch up with you. And congrats on this movie and
Thanks.
All that's to come.